Sudbine koje su znale stati u samo jedan kovčeg, onaj najranijih kolonizatora, prvi Britanci stupili su na zapadnoaustralsko tlo na području današnjeg Fremantla 1829. ili onaj kasnijih ekonomskih migranata, mnoštvo Britanaca, Grka, Talijana i migranata iz bivše Jugoslavije nakon Drugoga svjetskog rata ušlo je u obećanu i neotkrivenu zemlju kontinent upravo kroz ovu luku. Na takozvanim zidovima dobrodošlice, kako je nazvana instalacija tik uz obalu, imena su svih onih koji su udarili temelje moderne Australije.
From 1901 really till the early 1970s, so three quarters of the 20th century, Australia was a white country, and that was what was built into the psyche. It was only around 1973-1975 that things began to change very quickly. And it wasn't until probably 1978 or so that Australian governments began to talk about Australia as a multicultural society.
I think the statistics would say that we have been the most successful migrant and multicultural nation on earth. Around a quarter of Australians are born overseas. Nearly half of us have one or both parents born overseas.
Najpoznatiji australski političar hrvatskih korijena rođen je u Kamberi. Njegovi roditelji otišli su iz Jugoslavije potkraj 60. godina prošloga stoljeća. Upoznali se u Australiji. Pravnik po struci, velika je nada liberalne stranke, konzervativac, otac petero djece.
As a pretty young man, I was 27 when I got involved, and I was elected to the Senate in 2013. So I've had great opportunities. It's a great privilege to be a senator. It's a great privilege to be the assistant minister, and I just enjoy every day of that. And I guess it's part of that. It's part of the example of the fact that my generation, the generation of the, I guess, the sons and daughters of migrants, have had amazing opportunities in Australia, and I guess one example of that.
Ovo je priča o njima, generacijama novopečenih Australaca, o australskom multikulturalizmu i izazovima s kojima se suočava, imigraciji kao globalnom fenomenu, o gotovo 200.000 došljaka godišnje koji dosele na najmanji kontinent legalno. Sve do ukidanja politike Bijela Australije 1973. glavnina useljenika u državu kontinent bili su Europljani. A onda je Australija punim plućima prodisala, živjela desetljeća u kojima je promijenjen kulturološki kod nacije. Danas je primjerice 42% stanovništva užeg područja Sidnija rođeno izvan Australije. To je 13% više od New Yorka i čak 20% od Pariza.
Probably the biggest, most significant change was in 1989, when the Australian government essentially opened the borders to refugees from China following the Tiananmen Square incidents of that year. And there were about 40,000 Chinese studying in Australia at the time, and the government said they could all stay.
U ovdašnjim domovima govori se više od 300 jezika, uključujući domorodačke. Svaki peti Australac kod kuće ne govori engleski. Najzastupljeniji jezik u tom korpusu stanovništva je mandarinski.
The Asian immigrants, meaning people born in Asia, just under 2 million, and in statistics maybe, you know, around 10% or so. The community has been not just growing but diversifying. Historically, the Chinese were important, and then more recently, Vietnamese, Indians, even smaller communities of our Koreans.
Australski popis stanovništva iz 2016. ukazao je na nekoliko zanimljivih demografskih fenomena, ali najbitnija spoznaja je ona da je prvi put u povijesti azijska imigracija brojčano nadvisila onu europsku. U Viktoriji, najmultikulturalnijoj australskoj državi, najbrojnija useljenička skupina prvi su put Indijci. S toga trona istisnuli su Engleze. Engleze koji su Indijce i doveli prvi put u Australiju na početku njihova kolonijalnog pokoravanja ovoga kontinenta.
Ova ulica ulica u Veribiju, dijelu metropolitanskog Melburna, nekada je bila većinski talijanska i grčka, danas njome vladaju Indijci i Vjetnamci. S obzirom na to da nema nastave na hindskom ili nekom drugom indijskom jeziku, starenje stanovništva i očuvanje jezika kod druge i treće generacije glavni su izazovi za ovdašnje Indijce, koji za razliku od Kineza u razvučenom Melburnu nemaju svoj grad u malome.
When I was doing interviews for my thesis, my participants were telling me in the late 65s and 1970s, they could not find Indian curry powder and they were really missing it. So they had to order it via a Greek fellow who used to import it. And it used to take a month to come. Now, of course, you can get up and walk to the nearest store and you can find any Indian specimen, you know, spice you want.
Hindski i panđapski najbrže su rastući jezici u saveznoj državi Viktoriji. Indijci danas čine 2% stanovništva Australije, ima ih gotovo pola milijuna. Put suvremenoj indijskoj migraciji na kontinent utrli su studenti, koji su počeli pristizati masovnije, organiziranije, između 50. i 60. godina prošlog stoljeća. Danas se većinom doseljavaju visoko obrazovani, koji imaju veliku prednost. Izvrsno govore engleski.
Australia realizes that it's part of the global economy and it also needs immigration to keep its economy going. For instance, you know, the agricultural produce. There are no Australians to pick the produce, harvest the fruit and the vegetables. So it's the immigrant labor that does it. And similarly in the, you know, IT technology, we haven't got the infrastructure, so the Indians have to fill the niche.
Prvi australski veleposlanik u Kini nakon uspostave diplomatskih odnosa dviju zemalja izjavio je te povijesne 1973. da će za 100 godina Australija imati stanovništvo puti boje meda, misleći pritom na dotok Kineza i Indijaca na kontinent. Bile su to očito proročanske riječi.
The last election, there was a Egyptian Coptic Arab, another Egyptian Muslim, a number of indigenous people who were all elected in the last election, federal election. But Chinese, not very much.
Najstarija kineska četvrt na južnoj hemisferi nalazi se u Melbourneu. Za kinesku zajednicu, osobito prvu generaciju doseljenika, mjerilo uspjeha oduvijek je bilo što brže bogaćenje, a ne penjanje na ljestvici društvenog statusa. I tu treba tražiti razloge pod zastupljenosti Australaca azijskih korijena u političkom i javnom životu, uzme li se u obzir koliko su utjecajni u poslovnim krugovima. Gotovo da ih nema ni na vodećim pozicijama unutar akademske zajednice, dok se sveučilišni kampusi sve više pune novim mladim znanstvenicima iz Azije. Na australskim sveučilištima studira naime 150.000 kineskih studenata.
At the full professor level, the percentage is very low. About 4% of our full professorships are people of Asian background. Among university presidents, we refer to them as our vice chancellor, not one person of Asian background.
Reina Teng ugledan je melbunški odvjetnik, partner u odvjetničkom uredu specijaliziranom za korporativne i međunarodne poreze. Dijete imigranata, nakon više od 150 godina postojanja Pravnog instituta države Viktorija, izabran je za prvog čelnika te organizacije azijskih korijena. Potvrdit će da za odvjetnike azijskog podrijetla postoji stakleni strop.
In terms of partners in firms, that was around 3.1% of partners were from an Asian Australian background. It dropped by half when we looked at the bar to around 1.6%. And then in the judiciary, it was less than 1% of the judiciary were people from an Asian Australian background.
Dio se razloga reći će mnogi nalazi i u konfucijanizmu, čija je filozofija u suprotnosti s agresivnim stilom samopromocije karijerizma, tako svojstvenog zapadu.
The Chinese population are very focused on putting down strong economic roots, and they're not very interested in getting involved directly in politics. You know, they see politicians as less, something slightly less than human, and that you need politicians to run the place, but you don't want to be one yourself.
They very much flourishing, very much succeeding in business, right? They're not the link to our biggest trading partner at state level, at federal level. They got the business acumen, they got the link there, the family link, the network back in China, so they the trade and the business investment relationship between the two countries is through them, and they play that part very much so.
U australskom melting potu krčkaju se i drugi začini. U telefonskom imeniku Melbourna, vjetnamsko prezime Nguyen primjerice, drugo je najčešće nakon Smith. Većina od gotovo 300.000 Vjetnamaca u Australiji živi u Viktoriji i Novom Južnom Velsu. I oni su sve važnija stavka u nacionalnim cenzusima, koji svakih 5 godina iznova zrcale evoluirajuću Australiju, Australiju 21. stoljeća.
The hundreds of thousands of international students who are in Australia were never counted. After 2006, the international students get counted even though they're going to go away. So it's not quite so clear a question, but it is the case that permanent settlement from Asia is rising as a proportion of the new intake.
Viktorija je i u 2017. bila najbrže rastuća australska država. Za dva bi desetljeća njezina metropola Melbourne, u kojemu živi 40% stanovnika rođenih izvan Australije, mogla postati najveći grad u zemlji. Multikulturalnost je oduvijek jedna od njegovih najvećih kvaliteta, koliko god to ne bilo drago svim dionicima društvenog i političkog života.
We should distinguish between multiculturalism as a matter of fact, which is really just a function of having a diverse number of people, you know, diverse people from a number of societies all living together, and multiculturalism as government policy that is somehow about perpetuating cultural separatism rather than securing universal goods, universal institutions for everyone.
I come from Iraq. It's
keep going.
Speak Arabic and some English.
Jedan od centara u okolici Sidnija u kojemu pridošlice imaju pravo na 510 sati besplatnog učenja engleskoga u prvih 5 godina novoga života na obećanom kontinentu. Predavanja u 3 smjene pohađaju dobrovoljno, mogu učiti i na daljinu.
For this year, something like 60,000 people will be participating in the program, and the Australian government invests almost $300 million a year on an annual basis for that 60,000 students, refugees and migrants participating in the program. Of the 60,000, about a quarter come from a refugee and humanitarian background, and the other 75%, they are actually from family and skilled background.
Tečaj učenja jezika završava i Maisal Saberi, koja je u Australiju stigla potkraj 2016. s roditeljima i četvoricom braće, nakon više od 3 godine provedene u izbjegličkom kampu u Jordanu.
When I came here, my dream was to be a teacher. That was my another challenge for me here, because they said that I have to study for more than 6 years and 2 years experience. So I changed to community service because I love to help people.
Navitas osigurava sve usluge za uspješnu integraciju onih koji su dobili humanitarnu vizu do godinu dana nakon njihova ulaska u zemlju. Osim učenja jezika, pomažu oko zapošljavanja s obzirom na postojeća znanja i vještine došljaka.
We are paid per hour per student, so whatever hours they use, that's what we are paid for. If they are sick, if they are not here, so we're not paid for this.
One of the unique features of the program is that we provide childcare for those people who have children who want to attend classes. So when they're in class, their children are actually in childcare.
Statistika kaže da četvrtina izbjeglica u prvih 5 godina života u Australiji ne nađe posao koji odgovara njihovim profesionalnim kvalifikacijama.
We also run employment services also through the federal government that support people to do what it takes to get a job in Australia. So that could include being able to construct a resume, understanding Australian workplace culture, which can be different from a lot of other countries. Each month we place about 500 people in work. I think on average there's about, we help support people to start businesses, 25 businesses a month.
Baširu je 60 godina. U Australiju je došao u poznoj 57. nakon dvije izbjegličke godine u Kurdistanu, gdje je mogao raditi kao internist u hitnoj. U Melbourneu je pak obitelj sirijskih Kurda počela od nule. Troje djece moralo je ispočetka na ovdašnje fakultete. Stanarinu i dalje plaća država. Sin i starija kći zarađuju radeći honorarne poslove. Za razliku od žene, Bašir ne radi već 3 godine. Uz sladavanje engleskoga, razlog je i mukotrpan put priznavanja liječničke diplome.
We need to work because a person without work is a low valued for me. Yeah, you need to work to beginning your life.
Iračanka Marija Džavar stigla je u Australiju kao izbjeglica 2009. nakon 3-godišnjeg boravka u tada još mirnoj Siriji. Danas radi na recepciji Navitosova centra u Liverpoolu, pomaže korisnicima.
Communicate to the doctor. Fill in forms, talk to the central link. Many appointments happening in the first year, and settlement as well. When you have to look for accommodation to settle, it's all these things needs a language, culture shock. Kids like different rules. They learning here in school what we learn them. So we know that's the rules, what's happening in Australia by the kids as well, so we're learning.
Oko 90% onih koji dobiju humanitarnu vizu već ima rodbinu ili prijatelje u Australiji. Vlasti se trude smjestiti ih što bliže jedne drugima. Veće skupine istih etničkih zajednica po mogućnosti na istoj lokaciji. Diljem kontinenta u čak 70 gradskih središta gdje će pronaći svoj dom, pridošlice će prolaziti programe prilagodbe.
They have mental health issues like PTSD, anxiety, separation issues. Then I help them with referring them to provider services appropriate for the clients.
U prva 3 dana od dolaska u Australiju, imigranti se registriraju u bazu podataka na temelju čega poslije dobivaju socijalnu pomoć. Otvore bankovni račun i dobiju porezni broj, bez kojega ne mogu zasnovati radni odnos. Uđu u bazu korisnika javnog zdravstva, dobiju pomoć oko smještaja, upišu djecu u školu i uključe se u program besplatnog učenja engleskoga za odrasle. Sve dok ne nađu posao, država ih financijski pomaže, imaju i besplatne zdravstvene usluge. Kako bi se što bezbolnije uklopili u novu sredinu, savjetnici s obiteljima u prosjeku rade između 6 i 12 mjeseci.
A lot of them just really have a heart to want to give to people and just want to help them. We do have a lot of volunteers who have been migrants or refugees themselves and just want to give back to the people that are coming in. They want to help the community.
Jedan od njih je Iračanin Nasir. U Australiju je stigao 2009. s djetetom i suprugom, čija obitelj već bila ovdje. Nije bilo lako. Bagdad je zamijenio Melbourneom u 49. godini. Smatra da će mu volontiranje za druge izbjeglice otvoriti vrata na ovdašnjem tržištu rada. Napominje kako je bitno da se angažiraju ljudi iz podneblja iz kojega stiže sve više izbjeglice na kontinent.
This diverse workforce and volunteers, they have an insight of what these people have been through. And they speak the same language and they have the same habit and culture to help them.
Samoanski tradicionalni ples na godišnjemu festivalu svih etničkih zajednica u Melburnškom predgrađu. Viktorija je najmultikulturalnija. U njoj završi 1/3 ukupnog broja izbjeglica i imigranata koje Australija godišnje primi. A od Drugoga svjetskog rata do danas prihvatila je više od 900.000 izbjeglica. Na toj je snazi najbrže rastao Melbourne, koji sada ima gotovo 4,5 milijuna stanovnika, samo 400.000 manje od Sidnija. Za 3 desetljeća, kažu demografi, broj stanovnika Melbournea mogao bi se udvostručiti. To će se najviše osjetiti u imigrantskim predgrađima. I Islamski muzej Australije, priča o bogatom kulturnom nasljeđu i povijesnom doprinosu ovdašnjem društvu australskih muslimana. Sredinom 19. stoljeća vrata nepristupačne unutrašnjosti kontinenta otškrinulo je oko 2000 došljaka iz današnjeg Afganistana i njihovih 20.000 deva. Kao trgovci, ali i radna snaga, sve dok ih nisu istisnuli željeznice i motorna vozila.
Afghans tried to assimilate, which was the policy back then in Australian community. Many of them actually married Australian wives, and now so they created their own towns, and they created, now there is a train link that actually is called the Ghan, which comes from Afghan.
Sayed je jedan od 30-ak tisuća Afganistanaca koji danas udišu australski zrak. Došao je kao 11-godišnjak preko programa spajanja obitelji. Prošao porođene muke s jezikom, završio fakultet. Radi kao odvjetnik, jedan od rijetkih među australskim Afganistancima, te kao novinar. S ocem je osnovao humanitarnu organizaciju koja pomaže sunarodnjacima pristiglima u bolji život.
What we try to do is give a platform for young people to raise awareness, but at the same time give them the opportunity to reach their full potential, may it be in education, may it be in leadership, may it be in what advocacy or whatever they desire to do.
I on je lider, javno lice islama u Australiji, inspiracija umjetnicima. Walid Ali, javni je protivnik islamskog ekstremizma, zagovornik slobode govora, idol mnogih mladih obrazovanih muslimana. Sin Egipćana koji su u Australiju stigli 60-ih godina, odrastao u Melbourneu. Odvjetnik, pisac, glazbenik, danas omiljeni televizijski voditelj i predavač na sveučilištu. 2016. osvojio je prestižnu nagradu publike za najbolje australsko TV lice.
What that did is, for a lot of people, it symbolized a kind of maturation of Australian television, that finally Australian television was becoming a little bit more like the Australian population.
I think the speech that he gave was quite poignant, because he made the point that this is showing that Australia is changing, and Australia needs to get used to the fact that not everybody on their television screens are going to, you know, be white.
Australija ima jednu od najvećih koncentracija komercijalnih medija u rukama jednog vlasnika. Još nezdravije od toga je činjenica da su svi mediji Ruperta Murdocha zauzeli stajalište kako su upravo oni moralna kralježnica desnice u ovdašnjoj političkoj areni. Recept je iskušan. Ako vlada slijedi njihov pogled na svijet, neće je raščetvoriti i neće sustavno zlorabiti moć u podgrijavanju antimuslimanskih osjećaja kod australske krajnje desnice.
Nothing infuriates the people who are in that media environment more than intelligent, well-spoken, articulate, argumentative, insightful Australians who happen to be Muslim. It's almost like they've got a sore tooth, and this is like someone putting a hot needle into a sore tooth. Right? They lose it completely.
We do have, I wouldn't say a very ascendant far right in Australia. It's kind of there, but it certainly doesn't have the presence that it has in European politics or in American politics now. It is there though, and their response usually is to get upset with every success that I have. That's just kind of that's the equation, that's the formula, and you kind of just have to live with that, I think.
Muslimana ima manje od 3% u ukupnoj australskoj populaciji. Dio te statistike je i Bilal Cleland. Preobratio se na islam još 75. tijekom privatnog puta u Egipat. Umirovljeni učitelj engleskoga uglavnom je poučavao imigrante. Danas je kolumnist i pisac, upozorava na zabrinjavajuće trendove.
I was in the English as a second language teaching for many years, and are in the language centers, and I've just heard from colleagues that nearly all the recent immigrants brought from the Middle East are Christians. It seems to be some sort of religious discrimination in the present intake of immigrants. And I think this is very dangerous.
Socijalnu koheziju pitanje dovode političari poput prvakinje australske krajnje desnice, koja islam naziva bolešću. Ne pomaže ni to što velik dio parlamentaraca islam smatra političkom ideologijom.
I think that we should allow people freedom of religion. Now, do I personally like the burqa? I think most of us find it confronting, and it is, I think, it's worth saying that it's only a very small minority of Muslim women who would wear the burqa, certainly in Australia, and I think in most countries around the world.
Shireen Hassan po struci je profesorica kemije i fizike. Angažirala se u zajednici prije 15 godina. Želi da se čuje glas australskih muslimanki.
Some Muslims have responded to this negativity, to this Islamophobia by saying, you know what, I'm going to prove as a Muslim woman, I'm going to prove how empowered I am. I'm going to prove how capable I am. And that will be a motivation for them to go to the top of their career. And I personally know of so many Muslim women who are doing their PhDs, and every woman I know is either have completed their degree or postgraduate qualifications or are working. At the same time, then you'll find individuals who have responded to this over scrutiny of Muslims, this Islamophobia, by becoming more reclusive, more insular.
Povijest se ponavlja. Prije 20 godina na udaru australske krajnje desnice bila je emigracija iz jugoistočne Azije.
That fear is instilled by media, populist right-wing outspoken parties such as One Nation, other radical groups such as the United Patriot Front, and many others that are out there.
When I went to the Islamic conference in Chicago, I was amazed at how the American Muslims have swallowed the American nationalism and really assimilationism. And we're not forced, Muslims are not forced to assimilate here, but there is a strong move to integrate in the community, which I totally agree with.
We don't want people to come to Australia and feel that they are separate, that they are we are a nation of tribes. We want people to come and very much feel part of Australia. All of that integration agenda is about encouraging that. We do our bit to support that, but we ask people who come to Australia to become citizens that they also do their bit.
Miss Australia, I'm not sure if you've heard of this case, but her name's Esma Volador. She came to Australia as a Bosnian refugee, as a child, and her whole life she was so ecstatic that she was given this opportunity to live in Australia. And she's, you know, she's a gorgeous woman who was given the title Miss Australia, beautiful woman. In one of the interviews, one of the journalists asked her, are you Muslim? Because a lot of Bosnians obviously are Muslim. And she said, yes, I am. And then the verbal and written abuse ensued. The director of Miss Australia said that they have never received so much negativity and hate mail after the fact that the Miss Australia was announced that she was Muslim. And that's proved to me that the fact that there are individuals out there that will never be happy with you. Even this particular individual, she's a gorgeous woman, she's Miss Australia, she doesn't wear a headscarf, she wears a bikini on the stage, but the fact that she was Muslim, there are individuals out there that just couldn't tolerate the fact that Miss Australia was, you know, was Muslim.
The post-war arrivals of our Asians, they were mostly people who came here as students. From 1951 until probably the 1980s, Australia had a foreign aid program known as the Colombo Plan. Colombo Plan because the program was initiated at the capital of Sri Lanka. It was actually a Cold War initiative. With the help of Britain, New Zealand, Australia, and the US, they wanted to convert the thinking of young Asians by giving them scholarships in Australian universities, hoping that on returning to Asia, they would be the fighters against communism.
Jedan od njih jest i Hong Lim, etnički Kinez rođen u Kambođi. Nakon završenog fakulteta u Australiji, ipak se nije mogao vratiti u krvavu diktaturu Pola Pota. Agitiranje za svoje sunarodnjake pozicioniralo ga je u političkim krugovima kozmopolitske australske države. Danas je najdugovječniji zastupnik azijskih korijena u parlamentu države Viktorija. Bira riječi hvale za integraciju nekadašnjih indokineskih izbjeglica.
40 years later, just many of them are millionaire now, they really settled. You only had to go to those areas where, for example, in my electorate of Clarinda, Clayton, Springvale, the community doing extremely well. And now with the influx again of the mainland Chinese, people from the PRC, People of Republic of China, the scene is just completely different again, because these are people who are very affluent. They come with their business acumen, with their wealth, with their business skill, bringing trade and investment.
Kineski muzej u Melbourneu svjedoči o kineskoj prisutnosti u Australiji još od zlatne groznice 50. godina 19. stoljeća. Da politika bijela Australije početkom 20. nije desetkovala Kineze diljem kontinenta, Melbourne 21. stoljeća vjerojatno bi imao obrise Singapura.
Amongst the China-born, mainland China-born population, the last census shows 36% of those were Australian citizens. That is very low to start with. But then you compare it to Vietnamese Australians, and they're over 90%, they're higher than the broader population.
Dug je put prijeđen od 1975. kada ih je bilo svega 700. Početkom 80. godina prošloga stoljeća osnovana je Udruga australskih Vjetnamki kako bi pomogla pri smještaju i integraciji izbjeglica pristiglih u Viktoriju nakon Vjetnamskog rata. Upravo s njihovim dolaskom, australsko društvo prihvatilo je suvremenu azijsku imigraciju.
Australia knows that it owes a lot of its prosperity to immigration. And I think for the last 25 years, we haven't had a recession. It is mainly due to the fact that we have a lot of immigrants and they have brought a lot of skills.
Ideja asimilacije u multikulturalnom društvu odavno je mrtva, ali borba za političku prevlast itekako danas usmjerava ton javne debate o imigraciji. I vladajući i opozicija pooštrili su svoja stajališta. Prvaci desnog političkog spektra viču pritom kako migranti moraju postati australski domoljubi. Na tom tragu bila je i ideja desnih krugova o mijenjanju dijela zakonodavstva koji zabranjuje uvredu ili zastrašivanje zbog rase, boje kože i etničke ili nacionalne pripadnosti. Tvrdili su naime da zadržavanje takvih zakona ugrožava slobodu govora, jedan od postulata australske liberalne demokracije, i da je pravo slobode govora važnije od osjećaja uvrijeđenog ili zastrašenog pojedinca. Na kraju je članak zakona ostao nepromijenjen.
The multicultural community just come up very strongly that you cannot change. We would not allow you to do that because it would mean you are hitting at the core of what multiculturalism, what is Australia all about? About being fair, being giving everyone a fair go. But yet, if you touch on that, you're killing the spirit of being Australian.
Section 18C is actually a protection against hate speech. The fact that they wanted to change Section 18C and amended meant that that it could erode certain protections that minority groups in Australia have.
Vast majority of Australians support a multicultural Australia, well over 80%, but they also support freedom of speech. And the real question there is, how low do you set the bar? People would probably be shocked in many other countries that you would have laws where people can be dragged before the courts simply for saying something that might offend someone.
The only real way to protect people's freedom of speech in this country is to repeal the law in its entirety.
The legislation itself provides relatively little protection from racial vilification, and it provides very limited restrictions on free speech. So it actually doesn't do that much. It became a symbolic fight that, in my view anyway, was about the right to assert the cultural dominance of the cultural majority and a check on minority rights.
There's no way to limit any principle of offence by which you might circumscribe the right to freedom of speech. And so for that reason, there's never been a historically recognised right not to be offended. So that's the proper limit of freedom of speech is where it endangers people's physical safety, in the classic case of shouting fire in a crowded theatre and things like that.
Nevladine udruge tvrde da petina učenika u školi svakodnevno doživljava rasističke ispade, kao i trećina ljudi na poslu. Ni Australija nije pošteđena globalnih trendova.
Australia is lucky that we have measures where we have legal rights and legal measures where racism is discouraged and where racism is illegal.
Yes.
I don't think that we've seen any real problem with where people are coming from. I think to the extent that there's a debate about immigration, it's really about the number of people and the pace of change that we're seeing in Australian society, rather than any concern about where the people are from.
We can't continue to live that, migration, immigrants are taking our way of life, they're changing our values. What's going to happen next when the robots take over the life? Who are we going to blame then?
When there's job relocation to China, when the price of the house, new house, is going through the roof, affecting first-time young home buyer who cannot afford it. And when they see that so many Chinese students come here and take up places in the university, of course, they're starting asking questions. Now, what about us? What about me? What about my children?
Godišnje država izda više od 3 milijuna privremenih viza za kvalificirane radnike. Ovisno o produljenju ugovora s poslodavcem, mogu ostati i do 5 godina. Temelj nevjerojatnih 28 godina bez recesije bio je 10-godišnji bum rudarstva i građevinarstva na zapadu kontinenta, ali ekonomija svakako raste i na potrebama imigracije. Svake minute u Australiju dolazi živjeti nova osoba.
I think we are at a tipping point. I don't think we can continue to look forward to economic success in our region when we discriminate against people on the basis of the visa class, the race, the religious or cultural beliefs. There is a tipping point in which those things are at odds and that either the economic suffers or the social cohesion suffers.
U budućnosti će imigranti moći dobiti državljanstvo tek nakon 4 godine stalnog boravka u Australiji, uz polaganje testa poznavanja takozvanih australskih vrijednosti i zadovoljavanje znatno više od osnova poznavanja engleskoga. Tražit će se sveučilišni stupanj znanja jezika.
My cousin take it earlier, so she said it's easy. You have to just remember the information about the law in Australia, know about Australia, know about the Australian history. And it's going to be easy. For me, if you read the book, they will give you, and if you understand each and every word of it, it's not going to be difficult for you.
How can you test Australian values through an Australian immigration citizenship test? If you look at the Italians and the Greeks up to today, which is what, at least 6, 7, 8 decades, some of them can't even speak English, but they're the salt of the Australian community and its economy. They have contributed so much to it.
In our multicultural statement, we have a bit of a go at it. And I think that that's been picked up in some of this citizenship discussion. Do you support the rule of law? Do you support freedom of religion and speech? Do you support the equality of men and women? Do you support our parliamentary democracy, a free press? These sort of things that have helped underpin who we are.
The most significant of these is the question of female genital mutilation. Right? This becomes the quintessential question that determines whether or not you should be allowed to become an Australian. Right? If you support female genital mutilation, you have no place in Australia. If you oppose it, then you can come in.
The citizenship, I think, instrument would make it easier if it gets through Parliament for the Department of Immigration to then selectively, go for groups that they prefer and should, people of Islamic background be considered as less desirable.
Of course, you can read between the lines, you can see that they're aiming at trying to contain, the influence of Muslim preacher that came would be not being blended into the community and not speaking enough English and therefore only preaching hatred or encourage people to go and fight in the Middle East or whatever.
Young Australians, second generation Australians of migrant parents who have declared themselves by joining jihadist organisations enemies of Australia. So how do we demonstrate, how do we control this? Well, what we have to do, the government thinks, is to ensure that nobody who could ever become an enemy of Australia should ever become a citizen of Australia. And so that means, how do we work this out? Well, we can't say everyone who is a Muslim we're going to keep out, right? Because that can't do that in a multicultural society and it would just wreak havoc. So the government says, okay, let's try and find a set of values that are embedded in the people that we really don't want, and we will turn those into values that are un-Australian.
Da su nekada primjenjivane tako oštre odredbe o poznavanju jezika, mnogi od onih koji su izgradili modernu Australiju nikada ne bi kročili na njezino tlo.
There have been many influential Australians who have come out and talked about their own parents who have come to Australia speaking no English, perhaps for the whole time in Australia. However, they've gone on to live successfully in Australian life as well, and grown or had children that have, as I said, integrated into Australian society.
Nakon Drugog svjetskog rata, kada je morao nastati novi nacionalni identitet koji se ne temelji na krvi i teritoriju, Australija je nužno trebala održiv princip multikulturalnosti. To nije bilo problematično. Ovaj je kontinent dio novoga svijeta. Danas je Australija treći najveći primatelj imigranata u globalnim okvirima. Vlada stoga svake godine provodi istraživanje o socijalnoj koheziji. Kad procjeni da je potrebno, učini i politički iskorak. Poput objave izjave Multikulturna Australija, ujedinjena, jaka i uspješna, dokumenta koji određuje strateški smjer i prioritete politike multikulturalnosti. Posljednja takva izjava objavljena je na kraju 2017.
It was very much a unifying statement, but it talked about common Australian values. It talked about the importance of things like the rule of law and parliamentary democracy, equality of men and women, but also great freedoms as well, freedom of speech, religion, enterprise. These are some of the things that really make up a modern multicultural Australia.
Vrijednosti koje definiraju naciju s usađenim imigrantskim kodom duboko u sebi. Kontinent leži na neiscrpnim rudnim bogatstvima, ali najveći su kapital ove zemlje ljudi i njihova kulturna različitost.
For me, Australia is a wonderful country. Their people are really wonderful and they will take care of you and they will give you what you want. They always will ask about you, always make sure that you are fine if you need anything, if you need any help with job or study anything.
My dream come true. Good job, safe place, helping like a big opportunity to my family and my child as well. So that's, thank you very much to Australia to have us.
Ovaj crtež u Navitasovu centru nastao u povodu dana kojem Australci svakog ožujka, kada i UN slavi dan iskorjenjivanja rasne diskriminacije, obilježavaju svoju kulturnu raznolikost, uključivost, dijeljenje zajedničkih vrijednosti i osjećaj pripadanja svih onih koji se smatraju Australcima, a Australiju svojim domom.
I have to give them back the money when I work. I will work hard and I give them Centrelink money back and I tell them thank you for your help.
Daleko je Australija dogurala od slogana naseliti ili izumrijeti, skovanoga nakon Drugog svjetskog rata, kada se preporučivao godišnji rast populacije od 1% uz poticanje masovne imigracije iz Europe. Kada je 1983. prvi put zabilježen veći priljev imigracije iz Azije nego iz Velike Britanije, mnogima je ponestalo zraka, ali proces je bio nezaustavljiv. Danas je zemlja kontinent dosegnula 25 milijuna stanovnika, gotovo desetljeće ranije nego što je bilo predviđeno. Uz Kanadu, koja ima 22% državljana rođenih u inozemstvu, 6 manje od Australije, mjerilo je multikulturalnog društva.
More importantly than just the percentages, I think, is about the social cohesion and the support for immigration. And the Scanlon Foundation does an annual survey about social cohesion. They were saying that around 83% of Australians support the fact that multiculturalism has been good for Australia.
Australija u posljednja dva desetljeća godišnje prihvaća između 12 i 13 tisuća izbjeglica. Spajanje s njihovim obiteljima danas ide sporije. Dolazak partnera ili roditelja u Australiju preko nekih od imigracijskih programa skup je i pravno do u detalje razrađen postupak.
The immigration problem will continue because so many people want to come over here. So many people because all their family here, obviously children or parents want to get their children here, or cousins, and so on, and the story will continue.
The conventional thinking if you are an Australian politician, is that in order to maintain support for that kind of demographic change, that kind of demographic makeup, the fact of immigration and our reliance on immigration as a country, then what you need to do is make sure that that process is an ordered process, and so that there's not irregular or what they will describe as illegal immigration, which is one of the reasons, and it's only one of the reasons, but it's one of the reasons that Australia has such an obsession with boats and with people coming to Australia on boat.
Australia has secured its borders with policies that are very strong. But it's this control of our borders that underpins people's willingness to have such a high level of immigration, to resettle so many people. Because we know that when people are coming to Australia, it's an act of our democratic will through our parliament. It's something that we can control. And that element of control gives people confidence in the program as a whole.
There is a lot that we need to start thinking about if we want to continue as a successful multicultural nation, which has benefited from the huge immigration flows that have occurred since the 1970s.
Our liberal heritage, our liberal institutions, secure freedom for everyone, regardless of their cultural background. If multiculturalism means abandoning those values, then that's a bad thing. But if multiculturalism simply means that we continue to have a number of people here whose origins are from all over the world, then I don't think that's controversial at all.
People really like that. If we go down to that extreme, it is going to divide us. It is going to affect us in every way. We're going to make enemies of each other, and that's going to affect our relationship, our peace of mind, our security eventually, and then our damage us economically. So people are very, very well informed about that, and they make the choice that we take the middle ground and then just watch out for the extreme.
We've seen a very strong shift around cultural values, in particular a sort of reassertion of a former dream time in the Australian white society, and a concern about the sorts of people who are coming in. Now, this is only a minority of the population, but it is a significant minority because historically they're people whose votes change a lot.
I don't think we still have the white Australia policy as an idea that people want to pursue, but it's important not to lose sight of white Australia policy and how it may have held Australia back in terms of its engagement with Asia.
Danas je australski multikulturalizam puno više vezan uz geografiju kontinenta, njegov geopolitički položaj, ali i ekonomsku ovisnost o Kini. 1.200.000 današnjih Australaca ima kineske pretke. Suvremena Kina, najveći trgovinski partner Australije, polako pak prodire u sve pore australskog društva. Pješački most preko rijeke Jara, koji simbolički povezuje prošlost i budućnost Melburna, izgrađen je još 1888. Tijekom obnove na njemu je postavljen niz čeličnih skulptura pod imenom Putnici. Svaka simbolizira jedan povijesni imigrantski val od davne 1788. do danas, kada Australija godišnje ima tri put veći priljev imigranata od SAD-a.
For me, Australia is a country of immigrants. So this whole country that you can see is made by immigrants, whether it's financial institution, educational institution, religious institutions, policies, whatever you can think of that is the fabric of society is made by an immigrant.
Pritisak na infrastrukturu Melburna i Sidnija, u kojima živi 2/5 australske populacije, postao je neizdrživ. Do 2030. ta dva najveća australska grada mogla bi narasti svaki do 8 milijuna stanovnika, tome uvelike pridonose došljaci. Razmatra se stoga uvođenje viza kojima će država nekim imigrantima, svakako ne onima koji se spajaju s obitelji ili onima koji dolaze zbog posla, odrediti mjesto za život u prvih 5 godina boravka u Australiji. Onima koji i nakon toga odluče ostati u slabije naseljenim regionalnim središtima, ponudit će se financijske povlastice uz pomoć u traženju posla. Jedno je sigurno, one koji svoju sreću potraže na drugom kraju svijeta legalno, čeka uređen sustav i velika šansa za ostvarenje australskog sna.